It is pertinent to note at this juncture that, upon assumption of high office, speakers normally find themselves isolated and confronted by the most arduous tasks and the intricacies inherent in speakership. The matter which is compounded by the lack of prior training for the job, whereas all of a sudden they have to contend with something that most people spend their lives avoiding, making decisions. Speakers rule on points of order and make a myriad of decisions on questions as and when they arise during the business of the House. Speakers at all times are required to walk a tightrope to carry out the most delicate and vital task of safeguarding and balancing the rights of the majority and the minorities, or of those who hold unpopular views, thereby managing the political diversity and pluralism in their respective houses. It is, however, unavoidable that the way it is done affects the style of the House, and every speaker comes in for a certain degree of criticism for favoring backbenchers or the government or the opposition, or to be criticized on all fronts simultaneously. It was for this reason that the aforesaid visionaries, under the able leadership of Dr. Chitendero, conceptualized a forum of colleagues, the speakers presiding in their national parliaments. The whole idea was premised on the understanding that this would enable them to draw on each other's experiences and acquire the requisite skills necessary for the execution of their duties. In time and upon consideration of the matter, speakers deemed it fitting and appropriate to expand the scope of the forum to include all those who bear the responsibility of representing their people in parliament. Due cognizance was also given to the fact that members of parliament assume their responsibilities without any specific professional qualifications, yet they too must make policy decisions in the face of rival demands of domestic society and the world at large. This line of thinking was also prompted by the glaring absence of a regional mechanism for parliamentarians of SADC member states to debate and inform the SADC summit of the popular views on development and other issues affecting the peoples and the countries of SADC. There was no mechanism for introducing and sustaining SADC's regional integration agenda in national parliaments. Therefore, the concept of the forum was pitched to a higher level of a consultative parliamentary body in the SADC region, with an ultimate intention of establishing a SADC parliament with full legislative powers, an institution which would enable the participation of elected representatives of the people in the work of SADC, thereby tapping into the synergy of skills and talents in this region. Ultimately, on the 8th of September 1997, the SADC Summit of Heads of State and Government approved the establishment of the SADC Parliamentary Forum as an autonomous institution of SADC in accordance with Article 9, Subsection 2 of the SADC Treaty. To the visionaries, speakers mentioned earlier, this was the most welcome development, as it meant the emergence of the voice of Parliament in SADC regional integration. The establishment of the SADC Parliamentary Forum has seen the achievement of a number of milestones, as it has already been alluded to, hence the reason for celebration. However, SADC Parliamentary Forum is currently not an integral part of SADC, and it is nothing more than an association without recognition from the leaders of SADC. This is by virtue of being established under Article 9, Subsection 2, which reads, other institutions may be established as necessary. The meeting will recall that in the preceding text I made reference to the ultimate intention of the visionaries to establish a SADC parliament with full legislative powers. This noble mission to transform the SADC PF into a SADC Parliament was perceived with vigor and determination. We knocked on every door, as my colleague has already indicated, lobbying the SADC Summit and our heads of state and government for support. I can still vividly recall my tenure as the chairperson of the SADC Parliamentary Forum, going from country to country presenting the case for the transformation. We expressed our desire for the Parliament to be established under Article 9, Subsection 1 of the SADC Treaty, so that it can assume a higher status and receive due recognition. It was envisaged that SADC Parliament will take the process of integration to a higher level and promote the political and socio-economic development of the region. Today, the status quo is that we have national parliaments and a continental parliament, but no regional parliament. It is our region, Southern Africa, that is lagging behind in this regard. Other regions boast regional legislatures such as the ECOWAS Parliament and the East African Legislative Assembly. We had a guest this morning from Guyana. I've heard the latest development that Southern Parliamentary Forum has finally been transformed into Southern Parliament. Now the question is it the kind of parliament you have been so eagerly waiting for? This remains to be seen. Nonetheless, I wish to once again thank the foresight and steadfastness of my former colleagues, the ingenuity of the then Secretary General, Dr. Pasika Motuka, and the Secretariat staff. May I conclude by wishing the Secretary General of the SADC Parliamentary Forum a speedy recovery. I thank you for your kind attention.